All right, North-South Connection, welcome to the 25th WrestleMania computer. That is the Hot Rod, Rowdy Piper. I am here with Scott Keith. Scott, what is going on?
Not too much today. Got the day off, so we're just hanging out and talking WrestleMania.
That we are, and we're talking about a very crucial WrestleMania competitor, and that is the Hot Rod. When I say Rowdy Piper in WrestleMania, what is the first thing that comes to mind to you?
For me, it's always the Adrian Adonis match, but some people it's the Bret Hart match, obviously. So he's a guy who's got an eclectic resume, you know, you can't deny that.
Yeah, it's definitely an interesting resume, that's for sure. But it's more of a legacy play here at 25. I felt Piper, that was kind of hard to weigh in on where to put him on the countdown, but I feel that 25 is a very respectable spot for him with his match resume not necessarily so strong.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, well, WrestleMania 6 definitely falls under that for sure. Yeah, not so strong, yes. Anyway.
We'll get to that one in a second, but let's kind of just start at the top. Yeah. The inaugural main event to WrestleMania. Pat Patterson is the referee. You have Paul Orndorff and Rowdy Piper versus Mr. T and Hulk Hogan. You know, it's a gentleman's three match. 3.25 if you want to play to the history. Chad went 3.5, Canton 2, and Meltzer didn't even rate it. So at an average star rating at 2.75, I feel that's respectable. A gentleman's three is kind of the perfect synopsis to this main event.
No, I mean, it's a match I must have seen 50 times in my life. I couldn't even tell you a single thing about it, I don't think. Like, it's incredibly forgettable. And as a match, obviously, there's bigger things going on at the WrestleMania show as far as the matches go. But, you know, hey, it's the one that drew the house, as they say. But, yeah, Piper's involvement in it, like, he's, especially at that time in his career, was never, you know, was an in-ring guy. Like, most of the match was Hulk Hogan selling and, you know, Mr. T coming in and doing his spots and Paul Orndorff doing the bulk of work. Yeah. So.
Yeah, it was a decent match. Definitely okay. But it had a big ping pong effect. Hot Rod would go on to kind of blame Orndorff for the loss, embarrassing him or whatever. And that would kind of spring into some big business, but that's not WrestleMania business. So unfortunately we're not going to really get into it, but what we're going to get into it is the next year's New York version of a main event. And that's Mr. T versus Rowdy Piper in a boxing match,
yeah.
Historically, this is not as fondly remembered as the main event. It's kind of a absolute clusterfuck, but it's in a entertaining kind of way because Piper is so quirky and T kind of feels like he's at the last leg of him being a wrestler. What do you think of this boxing match here?
I mean, I can't hate it. You know, like Meltzer gave it -5 stars, which I think is, you know, it's goofy and stupid, but I mean, you know, like it's kind of the stuff that you'd see in WCW years later, right? Like that sort of thing, like a big influence on the when Scotty Flamingo was doing his boxing match with Johnny B. Badd. Like that's the kind of category that it fell under for me, right? Like, you know, Rowdy Piper going out just being himself and being goofy with you know, getting an easy night's work basically with Mr. T. In some cases, it's actually an okay match if you're looking at it from that perspective. I mean, you know, the body slam finish for the DQ and, you know, whatever. I'm absolutely not as offended by it. I can see the time where Meltzer would have been really offended by it. But I mean, over time, you know, it's completely harmless fun is the way I look at it.
Yeah, it's okay. It's like 1.752, you know, 2 is okay for me. So it's what it is, but you know, Piper is so good in it at some aspects that it kind of drags that just structure and whateverness that it is to its okay spot.
Well, yeah, because clearly Mr. T did not give a crap at all at that point, and it was just in it for the paycheck, right? So it was all going to be on Rowdy Piper to carry the whole thing. And I again with an anchor like Mr. T at that point in 1986, I think it was about as good as it was going to be.
And I can see why they did it, coming off the success of WrestleMania 1, kind of going to that well again with Mr. T. Just structure-wise of a boxing match, probably wasn't the best idea. But again, they had to protect Piper and they had to protect T, and it's what we got.
Yeah, exactly.
And the next year is what we got is a hair versus hair retirement match. And that was a versus Adrian Adonis. What did you think of this match, Scott? Kent went 2.5, Meltzer 3.5, and Chad 3.
I'm actually surprised Meltzer went that high on it, to be honest. It didn't seem like normally be his thing. For me, it's always been like 2 stars for the in-ring action and 5 stars for entertainment value is the way that I've always put it, right? Like that was very, very influential of other matches where it was like all about the smoke and mirrors and the gaga, right? But Piper had everybody eaten out of the palm of his hand with that one. So again, the gave us a lot of notable things. Gave us the creation of Brutus the Barber Beefcake.
Yep.
That spawned out of it. And like the feud that led up to it, obviously was one of the defining things of my childhood as a wrestling fan. With Roddy Piper going on the flower shop, getting attacked by Adrian Adonis, and he came back with the baseball bat and smashed it up, which is like the best acting that you're ever going to see in wrestling. Oh. Just watch Roddy Piper and the way he emotes in those segments where he destroys the flower shop, and it's just like he's just amazing. It's like he looked like a bigger star than anybody else in Roshan, and just kind of like drew you in, even if you didn't know him as a wrestler. Like he was this underdog, scrappy guy coming on with a broken leg and just, you know, getting his revenge here. So like yeah, and then of course the storyline building up to it too, with Beefcake accidentally getting the haircut from Adonis, and yep. And the promos leading up to that, and just yeah, just perfect entertainment pro wrestling, even though it, of course, didn't end up that Piper actually retired from that.
It's pro wrestling.
Yeah, it's pro wrestling. Yeah, exactly. But yeah, you know, Adonis tries to get the sleeper and lets go too early because he's too arrogant, and then Piper gets his own and puts him out, and you know, has the great moment with Howard Finkel and walks out to the, you know, adoration of the fans, and Brutus Beefcake is launched as a new top baby face out of it, and just yeah, it's amazing. It's everything that's great about pro wrestling, I think.
Great business. And you can see the building blocks too, with Adonis cutting his hair like at one of the big shows before leading up to it, but whatever. It's yeah. Very memorable. When I think of this match at WrestleMania 3, I think of Piper running down the aisle, and this the ovation he gets, and the star that he looks like. Everyone comes down on the carts and he's sprinting to the ring, and yeah. Just the aura and the everything is just spewing out of him. I love that moment.
Yeah, for sure. The man knew how to work a crowd.
Well, he didn't really know how to work. He couldn't really read a crowd at this next one, so to speak. I suppose,
yes.
WrestleMania 6 versus Bad News Brown in a singles match early on in the card. Meltzer 1.75. Again, that's high.
That's high.
Canton 1 and Chad half a star. Andre the Giant would play the prank on him and diluting the solution that would get the half of the black body paint off of his body. But, oh, man, this is a mess for a return match for Piper.
Yeah, bad idea written all over it. I mean, yes. I don't know who didn't tell him it would be a bad idea before he went out to, you know, to do it in the first place. But I don't even understand what the point was supposed to be of the whole thing. Like, it just it made no sense and ruined what could have been, like, you know, hey, it's Bad News Brown and Rowdy Piper, right? Like, they could have had a really decent brawl, and instead it's a kind of a punchline in history. And I don't even know. I think it's still on WWE Network. I haven't checked recently to see, but last I heard they had actually, there was a point when they had edited it off, in fact. So I don't know if it's back on there or not, but yeah, that's that one sums up. It didn't age well, is the phrase.
Yeah. And even in the structure of the match, where like they would go in there and they would brawl, and then they just start turning into a walking brawl and a double count out. And with this walking brawl, there was zero selling. There was like just haymaker after haymaker. And it was just nonsensical and didn't make sense from the jump. And with these two, it's either or. It's going to be an absolute clusterfuck and not work, or it's going to be a pretty good home run, because, you know, you would think that they would mesh together, but it was the first. It was an absolute clusterfuck.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Well, yeah, the less said, the better.
Yep, but this one was the classic. This is an all-time match for him. Bret Hart, Hoosier Dome, WrestleMania 8, Intercontinental Championship, Meltzer 3.5, that's low, Canton 4, Chad 4.25 stars for an average of 3.92. This is easily his best match. This is an all-time match. This is high on anyone's WrestleMania match list, and I adore this match. I think I'm at 4.5.
Oh, yeah. I was at 4.25 myself. Absolutely. Yeah, I always loved this match. This was the match that, you know, made Bret Hart into a big star again. That was Piper's whole goal with getting the title, and, you know, he just wanted to go out and make Bret Hart into a star, and he did it. Like, you know, Bret Hart looked like the biggest star, like the one of the biggest stars that they had after the match.
Yeah, and even the promos before with the one piece of bologna on the sandwiches and the family and all that stuff. Yeah. Piper was on, and I believe this is the first time Piper had a pinfall in the WWE.
I believe it is as well. Yeah, he didn't. They might have been one with Snuka, but yeah, he certainly didn't that often. The match gave us like some iconic bits they've been ripping off ever since. Yep. Piper, you know, teasing using the ring bell and then changing his mind. So they've recycled that one. Bret Hart with his, you know, with the winning pinfall where he reversed the sleeper. Okay. Remember that? So that actually became part of his regular moveset, and something that lots of people have used since then as well. So like, yeah, just like an insanely influential match. And it was just fantastic.
Yeah, for sure. Now on the same wavelength as bad news in Piper, where it's going to be a home run or a strikeout. I actually adore this next match, and that's Goldust, the Black Rock Ball. It's like sports entertainment to the T. Of course, it has its quirks and whatnot, but I really love the pre-brawl in the parking lot where Piper breaks his hand. And, of course, it gets a little wonky with the car chase and the lingerie or whatever. But as a whole, I do adore this. Meltzer didn't rate it. Canty gave it half a star, and Chad gave it 3.25. I would probably say I'm about with Chad there on that one.
I just reviewed the show again, actually, because I was as part of my 96 Superstars run. Okay. So I got to WrestleMania. Yeah, I just redid it. And I'm kind of, I guess I'll waffle and be like, yeah, I really liked the first half. The parking lot brawl was good. And then, yeah, the Bronco and the weird stuff in the ring, not so much. They should have just left it with a parking lot, I feel like. But I mean, hey, honestly, given that the position that they're in, you know, Scott Hall was, you know, off being.
Yeah.
Scott Hall, you know, the Piper was in a bad position. You put him in there. They did the best they could with what they had, right? Like, you know, there people were expecting this crazy brawl with Razor Ramon and Goldust, and Piper was able to go in there and deliver and seem like he wasn't a terrible substitute for it. So I'll give him that. I would have just ended in the backlot portion, like just do that and like, you know, not try to go with the pop culture stuff with OJ and all that kind of thing, right?
It's like, all right, what are we doing here? But I'm like, okay, I'm kind of intrigued. It's a whatever. And then, like, when we get to the ring with the lingerie, it's just like, all right, what are we doing? But I'm still drawn to Piper here. I'm still into it to an extent. And I overall like it.
Yeah, fair enough.
But then we get the WrestleMania 25 here. You did a great job talking about this with Steamboat earlier, so we won't really sink our teeth too deep into it. But overall, I thought that Piper was a little bit better than Snuka in the match, but he was not Ricky the Dragon Steamboat.
No, definitely. No, they're both better than Snuka. But yeah, Piper was, of course, you know, having a bad time in his life with everything going on health-wise. And, you know, he was fine. He went out there and he did the... You know, he was still Roddy Piper and did the Legends appearance. But, you know, overall, yeah, it should have just been a singles match with Chris Jericho and Ricky Steamboat if they were going to do something like this. Piper didn't really add much to it, unfortunately.
No, but those strikes in the corner didn't look too bad when he got in there for a little bit. He could still throw his hip into those strikes and make it look pretty decent for that.
Well, maybe they should have had him Piper in there with Mickey Rourke or something if Mickey Rourke wanted to be a part of it, right? He could have made that work, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, they kind of look
the same. There's your boxing match, right? You know, hey.
Oh, fuck. Yeah, there we go. We could have had 23 years later. But anyways, yeah. But when I think Piper, I think legacy and I think like importance to WrestleMania and the WrestleMania main event. But let's just kind of take a quick truck down his extras here and let me know at the end what you think sticks out the most. WrestleMania 5, the Piper's Pit with Morton Downey Jr. Yeah. WrestleMania 7 in Virgil's Corner versus DiBiase. WrestleMania 10, the main event as the referee in the Bret Yoko match. What do you say? WrestleMania 11 versus Bret and Backlund in the submission match. The run-in at WrestleMania 19 during the Vince and the Hulk match. And that epic, I love that match. I don't care. And Piper running in just added to it. That's probably my favorite so far. You know, the WrestleMania 21 Piper's Pit with Stone Cold. That ceiling mark was so high, but I thought they did pretty good there with Carlito coming in. And of course, at WrestleMania 21, he was also inducted into the Hall of Fame. WrestleMania 30 backstage with Mr. T, Hulk Hogan, and Paul Orndorff with Pat Patterson kind of walking in to do a callback to WrestleMania 1. And then WrestleMania 31, he did like the yes stuff with Daniel Bryan and the Legends after the IC ladder. Now, with all those WrestleMania extras, of course, his legendary status was kind of leaned on as for extras. But what would stick out to you the most?
Yeah, I mean, like with all the appearances, really, it makes his WrestleMania legacy seem like more of one of star power than, of course, anything that was
for sure.
In the ring, right? He was the guy they called in to make it look like something was a big deal. I still remember, of course, WrestleMania 5, like the Morton Downey Jr. interview, which made no sense. Like, you know, why are any of these people involved in it? How did he know there was going to be a fire extinguisher underneath the stool? You know, like, what?
Brother Love does steals his gimmick at first, and then it's the Brother Love show. And
yeah, exactly. It was complete train wreck. But I mean, and I usually fast forward through it when I'm reviewing WrestleMania 5 again now. But the referee job with Bret Hart as well was another underrated one. Like, you know, they needed somebody to be a big star for a referee, and he was the guy that was going to go there and legitimize Bret Hart again. You know, like, hey, I guess if you need Place to make Bret Hart into a big star, you call Roddy Piper.
But what do you say, Scott Keith? Do you want to quit? What do you say? That was, it's so bad, but it's now it's memorable. It makes the match, it's a bad match, but it makes the match like laughable and somewhat a little bit more enjoying from a comedic standpoint.
Well, I mean, it's funny because Bret hates that match so much, right?
So much.
He constantly bitches about it. But yeah, I mean, you know, yeah, hey, Roddy Piper was out there and not taking it seriously, you know, whatsoever. It didn't seem like, but yeah, he made that part of it watchable for sure. Like, and, yeah, sticking the microphone in poor Backlund's face when he's in there, just.
What do you say? But what did you think about 19? You had Vince versus Hulk, of course, the street fight or whatever. Yeah. I adore it. I think it's fun. It's kind of right up my alley of wonkiness, but with like brutality. And then Piper kind of sneaking his way in and kind of going on like a little run here when they stick him with O'Hare. What do you think of that spot at 19?
I was not expecting Roddy Piper to be coming back at that point. That's for sure. So that was kind of cool. I mean, yeah, definitely the Vince and Hogan match was a lot, as they say, exhibit pimping the ride to, I heard you like crazy spots in your wrestling matches. So here's all the crazy spots. And
There it is. It's a spectacle. Let's put it that way.
It was a spectacle. That's for sure. Yeah. Roddy Piper actually and Sean O'Hare was a cool pairing. Did really get, cause Sean O'Hare was not great as we all found out, but I think that was something that could have worked. And throwing Roddy Piper in there as a guest spot in that match was just the kind of craziness that the match warranted, I think. So it worked.
And I believe they came together pretty late too. I think that was kind of like a weekend of type of thing.
Oh yeah. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. It was very, very last minute that they had him in there. Cause I mean, obviously Piper was not in shape at that point, but hey, it's Roddy Piper, right? You know, throw him in there. He's gonna look like a star and people went crazy for it. So great.
Yeah, and then the 21 stuff with Austin was, on paper, so electric. And I felt that they just hit a nice, strong double there. I thought it was pretty cool. I like the slap, but I feel like maybe it just didn't fully click.
Yeah, probably not. It's, I'll be honest, everything after 20 kind of like flows together for me now at this point, because I'm old. Especially like the stuff, like the later on stuff, like the 30 and the with Daniel Bryan and all that stuff. It has to be really memorable for me to really be able to drag that stuff up anymore.
Yeah, for sure. That's absolutely. But as we get out of here and we kind of put our case out for Roddy Piper, do you feel like 25 was a little too high, a little too low, or just right? What are your overall thoughts?
I think it's just right. I don't think he had the body of work for great matches to be really any higher than that, but I think his star power was enough to carry him to a point where you think of WrestleMania and then, yeah, you're going to think of Roddy Piper. He was a part of the history for it, and I think that's a totally fair placement.
Cool. Well, Scott Keith, as we get out of here, what do you say?
I quit. I don't know.
Awesome. Scott, it was really fun, and thank you for jumping on.
All right. No problem. Have a great day.
What's going on? No So Countdown. This is Mike Rossi. I am joined here by Matt Farrell. How are you doing today, Matt?
I'm great. How you doing, Mike?
Excellent. I am excellent. And we are going to go through with number 24 on the list of greatest WrestleMania performers ever with Kevin Owens. Now, Kevin Owens really, from WrestleMania 32 on, he's been pretty much a mainstay. He did have WrestleMania 35 when he was hurt and unavailable. And then, obviously this year coming up, I'm assuming he ends up in something, which will then be his eighth Mania. Matt, when you think of Kevin Owens at WrestleMania, what's the first thing that pops up in your head?
Last year's Night One main event. I mean, I rewatched that just earlier today before we taped this, and I just wanted to pause it and go back in time and roll into the ring and just tell all four of those guys, I'm so excited for this. It was just a perfect story and a great match, and it just everything clicked.
Right. And it was like, I feel like that was a story that was really peaking because they really took their time with getting Zayn to turn baby and end up aligning with KO. And then KO obviously didn't trust him at first. So they really were only a team for 3 weeks or so leading into that Mania.
Yeah.
But it didn't matter. These guys are two people that could not talk for 10 years and just show up in a ring and be perfect tag partners. And the Usos were the perfect dance partners. So, yeah, we'll go right with that one as the first, because obviously it's by far the best KO match of this entire WrestleMania run for him. I had that as a 5-star. We look at Meltzer ratings was 5. Canton rating was 5. Ryan had it at 4.75. He's the one that had to be the slight Debbie Downer there. Now 4.75 is an awesome number. For a 4.92 average, I mean, this match was just so beautifully done. It was KO's back second straight WrestleMania main event, which we'll talk about the prior one here in a minute. As you're watching that show, were you just anticipating that match all night, or how did that go?
When it was announced it was going to be the main event of night one, it made me more excited to see it because I figure, you know, send the folks home happy. So I'm like, we're going to get the moment that we've been waiting for. And just all the callbacks in the match, it's calling back to previous Zayn and KO feuds, previous moments in the story with the Usos, just click after click after click, hitting every point. Just well done on every level, in-ring, story, the whole shebang.
Now, I saw a stat about this match today when I was doing some research. How many super kicks do you think there were in that match?
Oh, there's a stupid amount. I watched it today. Not that I counted, but I'm gonna guess 15.
I think it was 21 was the number that I saw today. It was actually Meltzer complaining about it, and the Usos were probably the vast majority of it. So, Meltzer wasn't complaining about it, but someone was comparing AEW to it. And he said, well, there were 21 super kicks in that match last year, which everybody loved. So, definitely an awesome match, told a great story. The tag title run might have been a little bit underwhelming after that, but that was more on WWE not really having tag teams ready for them. But just a perfect match. It got everybody their Sami Zayn moment, too, that they were waiting for.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I feel like this is more of a, like, of the four, KO is the fourth member of the story that was being told that night. But he's still a big part of that.
Yeah. I mean, the guy's so good. He's got so much of that. He's the only one that had prior WrestleMania main event experience going into this match. So he was good to have in this spot. And the match was ruled. I mean, we could talk about that for 20 minutes alone, but right. We won't. We're going to go right.
Yeah,
we're going
to go watch backwards. It.
Yeah, go watch that. If you've never seen that match, go check it out. It's a long one, but it's worth every second. And then we'll go backwards because KO's first WrestleMania event was kind of a perfectly put together match that wasn't made a match until it started, basically, which was the main event of night one of WrestleMania 38, which was in Dallas, Texas against the returning Stone Cold Steve Austin in a no-holds-barred match where KO did the honors to Steve Austin, which stopped a two-match WrestleMania winning streak for him. What do you remember about this build? What do you like about how they put this together? I loved it. I mean, obviously, in-ring, we weren't expecting a classic, but the crowd was electric. This was just a lot of fun to watch for 13 minutes and 55 seconds. Oh,
yeah. I mean, it's a 13-minute and 55-second pop. It's just the crowd is popping the entire time. I mean, considering there was a man in his 50s wrestling for the first time in 20 years, I mean, it's a really good match with those caveats. I mean, the moment is a 10-star out of 5. The build was just the one promo by Austin out in a field somewhere, and KO just complaining about how much Texas sucks is a little weird, but it didn't matter. It could have been just, you know, him just saying every week, yeah, I'm going to have a moment with Austin at WrestleMania, and everybody was in, you know, it didn't need anything. It was just to let you know, tune in because this is happening.
Right. Stone Cold's one of the few people in the history of this industry that could main event a WrestleMania off one promo and being called out on Raw a few times. I think that the match, where the match really became fun for me in the build was when KO did the fake Austin entrance. He came out with
I forgot about that. So that was great.
That was good. That's when things really got kind of turned up a notch, I think. And the crowd was, they just really hated KO for teasing.
Oh, yes. So molten angry.
Right. So it was really put together. I mean, that's somebody that I know Steve Austin loves. He loves his work. He loves talking to him. And KO, honestly, one of the nice guys in the industry from all accords. So this was probably a great moment for him to spend some time with one of his heroes in Stone Cold. So really cool moment. Definitely. So this was about a 3.42 average, with our high actually being Ryan himself at 3.75. So he was a little bit up on this one, but hey, the moment was a 10 out of 10. So I don't knock anybody there. And then the prior year at WrestleMania 37 was Sami Zayn. Now they only got 9 minutes and 20 seconds. And this was more of the Logan Paul show. What did you think about this match?
Well, I mean, when it originally happened and Logan Paul comes out, and I am a middle-aged man, so I had heard, I didn't know anything about him. I was like, who's this guy? Now, when I rewatched it this weekend before we recorded this, and I know who Logan Paul is from his work with WWE, it helped me enjoy the match a little more. At the moment, it was just like, I don't understand who this guy is. I am old. Can I just watch these two Canadians fight, please? It improves with age.
Yeah, and these guys worked really hard with their 9 minutes. They really integrated Logan into the story well. It's kind of disappointing when you hear about Zayn and KO getting a WrestleMania singles match. You're expecting this like 20-minute opus, right? But that's okay. We've got plenty of those in the past. They were able to tell a story here that made sense, and it was a little bit condensed from what we probably wanted to see as the fan. But to your point, Matt, when we look at where Logan Paul is 3 years later, it's a moment that I really think kind of holds up better than we maybe expected at the point.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, and if you remember, the story was much where Sammy was doing the conspiracy thing. KO just said he was stupid like 3 weeks before or something. It was just kind of like, hey, neither one of these guys have a dance partner, and we know it'll be good, so here you go.
And then at 36, which was the no fan WrestleMania, we had Seth Rollins and KO. Now, this match probably would have been one of the show stealers in a ticketed WrestleMania with a 80,000 gate or whatever they were going to have in Tampa that year, right? But they still did a lot. I know that KO's big hopes going into this match was being able to jump off of that pirate ship that they have down in Tampa. He didn't get that, but he got to jump off the gigantic WrestleMania logo in the PC. I thought this was a really strong match. I know Meltzer didn't rate any of them because they were taped, but it was probably the best in-ring match of the into that entire WrestleMania weekend. Maybe Charlotte and Rhea has something to say about that, but I thought that these two really worked hard. 17 minutes and 20 seconds. Now, obviously with no fans, 17 minutes felt like 37 minutes, right? Mm-hmm. But they worked hard, and these guys always had good chemistry together. What are your thoughts there?
Yeah, granted, on a COVID curve, it's good. Rewatching that this weekend, and you can, because this is pre pumped in noise, so it's dead silence other than the silence they're making. You can just hear the wind get knocked out of them on so many of these moves, and I kept thinking, guys, there's nobody here, like, you don't have to do this to yourself, right? But they beat the tar out of each other and really laid it out there, and the moment jumping off the sign holds up. It is unfortunate to have to hear that much Rollins talking just because of his voice, but you know, it is what it is in March of 2020.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, these guys really, you know, given the canvas that they were given, they did their best. And, you know, like I was saying, probably the match of the show. Now, this was a match that really kind of got put together based off Survivor Series, if my memory serves me correctly. He was questioning Kevin Owens' loyalty leading up to it, and because he was in War Games the night before for NXT. And, you know, it was really the first like full blown, I guess Jericho, he was a babyface too, but felt like KO was kind of in that upper portion of the card for this match. So it was cool to see him given this moment.
He is a heel against Jericho. And
that's right.
Yeah. It was his first face one, and it worked well. I mean, there's no crowd behind it, but Rollins is coming off as hateable. He's bringing up the fact that KO's never won at Mania. And so it told a nice story. It just, yeah, you know, got to grade it on, you know, the left-handed paint with your left hand.
Absolutely. And we'll go into that Jericho match. I don't know, for some reason I had the Festival of Friendship cross up in my mind there. But yeah, he was a full-blown heel here. Now, this was a match. We'll come back to 34 in a second. But at 33, this was for the United States champion. And I actually covered Jericho when we had him back at 35. So I talked about the match before. Right. But it was a U.S. championship match. They went 16 minutes and 20 seconds. This was a match that, you know, was probably going to be a world title match if Goldberg didn't get so over at that Survivor Series. And then KO dropped the title to him the month prior so they could do the Brock match. But this match is famously known as the WWE 24 segment where KO goes backstage and he talks to Vince. He's like, how was that match? And Vince is like, it sucked. He was a little disappointed by this one, right? And this was kind of flat. I put more of it on Jericho than I do on KO because I feel like Jericho wasn't really in the same level of work at this point that KO was. And it was really more of a story than it was meant to be a match. But what were your overall thoughts on this match back at Orlando 33?
If you want to call it WWE War, it's a replacement level. You know, like, it was fine. The Festival of Friendship, that all the stuff leading up to it was really good. And then the match was just kind of there. Wasn't bad. I didn't, like, regret spending time watching it. But it was nothing special. Told the match. And that was it, you know? It just a replacement level match. Fuck.
Yeah, felt like a Raw match more than it did a WrestleMania match. It was
TV main event is what it was.
With like a commercial smack dab in the middle. Yeah. That's what it felt like. And then we'll go to the first match of KO's WrestleMania career, and then we'll go to 34. But 32 was an IC ladder match, which was for the Intercontinental Championship. Opened the main show in Dallas, which had the record crowd, right? Was 15 minutes, 23 seconds. It was won by Zack Ryder. Other guys in the match were Dolph Ziggler, The Miz, Sami Zayn, Sin Cara, and Stardust, interestingly enough. Yeah. And, you know, we had kind of mentioned this earlier. KO was kind of a bit player in this. Mm-hmm. He was kind of just getting up to the main, starting to get his teeth wet with everything there. But really strong ladder match as a whole. It was about a four and a half, depending on who you listen to.
Yeah, I mean, it was a fun for a multi-man ladder match. But this is that era where they were kind of doing that every year, and it kind of just blends in with all the others. They kind of got away from the Money in the Bank, and then it was the IC title for a couple years. And it's just an odd group of guys when they all came out, you know, looking back 8 years later. And, of course, Sami Zayn's got to be in there. The only story in the match, other than, like, the guys want the title, is the KO Sami hate. I think it happened two or three times. It'd be like, well, it was just them in the ring together, and they would just come to blows. That was the only story other than, like, here's an insane spot. You know, it is fun. It's a good opener. It just kind of blends in with the rest of those ladder matches of that era.
Right, and it's one of those matches that I think if we had a two-night Mania in 32, there probably would have been a KO-Sammy singles match instead. Because you're right, that was kind of the crux of their story here. While obviously, like, Ryder and Miz were kind of another sub-story, and the rest of it was kind of oddballs, right? But, yeah, this was one that, you know, it was good to get their first WrestleMania moment for the two of them. But at the end of the day, yeah, we would have been a little bit happier, I think, for those two if they were in a singles match and kind of got to show the world at that point what they could do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like a coming-out party.
Right, exactly, because obviously the crowd was more exposed to KO than Sammy at this point because he had the feud with Cena. But all in all, it's kind of something that Two Night Mania would have given this a little bit more teeth for KO, at least. It was a good match regardless. And then we'll go to 34, which was, until he wrestled Austin, probably one of KO's favorite moments in wrestling too, was, you know, being in the ring with Sami Zayn as a tag partner in a heel capacity against Shane McMahon and the returning Daniel Bryan, who came back from, you know, the bevy of issues that he was dealing with between the head and the neck and everything. 15 minutes, 25 seconds. One of those matches that you kind of throw the star rating out and you just kind of soak in the moment. This WrestleMania 34 had two of those between this and the Ronda match, right? But this was that was actually probably a better in-ring match, right? But this was still, you know, it was Danielson's first match back. Shane has his limitations, but this KO and Sammy pairing was just so fun as heels together. It worked good. And, you know, even if the in-ring wasn't so super crisp, it was just, you know, it was a fun watch.
Yeah, I mean, as a just agents of chaos kind of characters that they were being at the time. I mean, it was way too much, Shane, as I watched this weekend. I mean, they're building and building for Brian to finally get tagged in. But with the four guys in there, and it seemed like 75% of the match is based on Shane. And that, right. I mean, me personally, like when I saw these star ratings on here from everybody, I was like, what? Because I watched it over the weekend. It was just like, no, this was, you're just waiting and waiting. And I guess, you know, out of the moment of it's been waiting for Brian all these years, I can, you know, building the anticipation in the match, but knowing that he's been going strong ever since and just watching Shane punch and just make He-Man comebacks against both of them is I don't know. That's just me.
Shane's working punches were rough to watch people have to sell for.
It was like, oh, can we just move past this part?
Right. So 7 matches for KO, 4-3 record. Now, what do you think hurts his resume here? 24 is a pretty good score, all things considered. He had a 3.79 match average for the cumulative that we're going by. But what hurts the resume here, but keeps him out of maybe the top 20?
I mean, I don't know. Okay, so he's main evented 2 nights of WrestleMania. And I think if you think of all the people who've main evented twice WrestleMania, he's probably got the least name value, at least up there. Just for some research, I texted friends who don't maybe flip through the channel and watch for a second. And I asked my son of a college, I asked all his doofus roommates, like, how many of you guys have ever heard of Kevin Owens? And it's about 50%. I haven't even heard the name. I feel like anyone else with multiple WrestleMania main events are, like, if not household, way more known than Kevin Owens. So I guess it's just like that he's very much in the wrestling bubble compared to a lot of your top people on, as we're going to hit into this list, I'd imagine. I don't know. Maybe I'm overthinking this.
Well, I mean, what I find interesting is when you look at his matches, like, take the ladder match out, because, you know, it's a ladder match. It's obviously going to be, you know, something that pops people. But as you look at his matches from 33 to 39, they kind of get rated higher as you go. I mean, obviously, the Austin match is kind of a blip in the radar. That was never really going to rate higher than it did, right? From an in-ring perspective. But he kind of gets his footing over time. And, like, as we go into 40, he's got 2 straight main events. He's obviously not going to have one this year, but he's somebody that they can lean on when they need him, right? And I think that that's something that you really have to think about with KO, is he's been so versatile for this company. I mean, we look at this, you know, heel, baby. Yeah, you know, then heel again, then baby again. So he's been able to be in high WrestleMania spots on both ends of the spectrum, maintain a 4-3 record throughout. Really, his resume is bolstered by those 2 main events.
Yeah.
I think if we did this after WrestleMania 37, he might not even crack the top 50, right?
Yeah.
Or 40, whatever we did. But at the end of the day, main events are main events. There's not many people that can say they main evented 1 WrestleMania, let alone 2. Right. So as a whole, I think that's where he had to be top 25. But kind of just at that point, and it really, what could have made it stronger is, like I was saying earlier, if he had that singles match with Zayn at 32, when it kind of called for it. A lot of these things that you see with him, really, you know, his resume would be stronger if we were doing 2 night WrestleManias through his career, you know?
Oh yeah. I mean, cause maybe that Jericho match is for a world championship on a split 1 like that. And the Daniel Bryan gets is more of a, it doesn't get lost in the morass of those ginormous WrestleManias that just are a slog.
Right. And flip side, without the 2-night format, he doesn't probably get either of those main events either. So he gets bolstered by it, while he also can get hurt by it at the same time. Right. Yeah. All in all, I think the rating's just right. Do you have any, like, argument with that?
No. I mean, he's a very solid, I mean, that's an all-time, that's a Hall of Fame resume. I mean, 40 years of WrestleMania and you're number 24, that's pretty good.
Yeah, and you main evented 2 of the 40, so that's a lot more, like I said, a lot more than a lot of people have been able to say. And it's fun for me because WrestleMania 30, which was my 2nd WrestleMania, obviously known as the Danielson Mania, right? I was at WrestleCon the morning of Mania, and Kevin Owens was still with ROH at that point as Kevin Steen. I shook his hand and took a picture with him that morning. And he said to me, he said, "Are you guys going to Mania?" I said, "Yeah." He goes, "Me too. I got to see my boy win the title." So it's cool to have that moment for me personally, just at 30, not too long ago. Yeah. And then I was sitting in that building in Dallas in 32 and being like, shit, this guy figured it out so quick. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So he's somebody that I always hold kind of close to my heart for that reason. And being able to see where he is at this point, just, you know, 10 years later, is phenomenal. To be talking about a guy I talked to in the morning of 30, wasn't even with WWE yet, we're talking about him 10 years later as a top 25 WrestleMania wrestler. So
yeah,
awesome stuff there.
Yeah. I enjoyed watching all of these over the week.
Great stuff, man. So, Matt, do you have anything that you want to plug before we head on out of here and get over to number 23?
My Twitter. I will post links to my C show from 2003 recaps that I do along with the Ruthlessly Aggressive podcast. And then I do these occasional videos. So just check the Twitter handle. That's if you want to see more of me, that's where I put all my things.
Cool. And you can see me on, as you know, Cronoso daily or monthly or whatever we do now, right?
Yeah.
We record that, you know, at least once a month, maybe sometimes a couple times a month. And, you know, it's March. So as you're watching this, it's WrestleMania season. To me, it's college basketball season as well. You'll be seeing me again, as I mentioned when we were talking about Jericho last week. You'll be hearing a lot about me talking college basketball in the next couple of weeks as well. So it's been a pleasure to spend some time with you, Matt, talking about KO.
Thanks, Mike.
And enjoy the rest of your WrestleMania season, all right?
All right.
All right, later, man.
Thanks.
North-South Connection. Here we are with the greatest WrestleMania performers of all time, perfectly timed for WrestleMania 40. I am the host of this episode, number 23. If Scott Criscola was here, we'd do numbers. And of course, 23, the Michael Jordan and Ryan Sandberg years. And, you know, if I'm going to do this number 23 episode, I need a partner. I need a tag team partner, someone who knows probably at least 23, number 23 is off the top of his head. The guru of basketball, I don't know, the saint of AEW, the savant of professional wrestling and independent movies, my good dear friend who I've known for many years, Andrew Reich. Andrew, any 23s? Shoot them off, top of your head.
Well, there's LeBron James. You said Rhino, because I did watch Ryan Sandberg on WGN for a while. Man, I'm just trying to think of random 23s now, and it's like, it's silly because I'm drawing a blank now. Now I'm thinking of like people who are wrestling who wore 23 for no reason. You know, you got WrestleMania 23.
That's true.
I was in Detroit and Cena beat Michaels and Donald Trump won, and then he won again 8 years later. I'm trying to think of like any football 23s and I think Lattimore was number 23.
See, I was hoping for some deep dive.
Pierre Thomas. Yeah. In the NBA, I don't know. I'm really like, after Jordan, nobody really wanted to do 23 again. That was the thing.
Indeed.
Like, in fact, the Miami Heat retired the number 23, even though Jordan never played there.
A somewhat classy organization.
Yeah. They have the culture. They have a very good culture, I've heard.
And we have a very good culture here at the North-South Connection. We've been involved with Place to Be Nation itself since day one, pretty much, both of us. So for those who don't know us, you know, of course, Andrew, you're on here for the AEW show. I've been on here as well. You've been around just doing the NBA team podcast. It just hit 300 episodes.
Yeah.
Congratulations. Yep. I believe the second longest running podcast, like full-on podcast, in all of the Place to Be shows.
In terms of episode number, yeah, it's not going to top the original with JT and Scott, but yeah.
Yeah, it's crazy. Of course, you can find me on Main Event. Andrew's been on there a lot too, but we're not here for any of that stuff. We're not here for current wrestling. We're not here for WNBA talk. We're not here for WNBA talk either. But we are here for Becky Lynch, number 23rd. Number 23 on the top 40 list. And the way we're going to look at this a little bit is kind of look at our memories and then kind of go through the matches, which have been beautifully put up on our screen here for everyone watching at home. Yeah. But Andrew, when I ask you about your first thoughts about Becky, when it regards to WrestleMania, what are your first thoughts?
An underdog. Like, even though she's in a lot of big time, you know, no pun intended, matches. Like, if you look at it there, a lot of them are for championships of some sort. There are some that are kind of like baloney matches that didn't really matter in the card, but Becky mattered. But the thing is, like, in almost all of these matches, there was a plausibility that Becky either did lose or was going to lose. There's actually, I believe, only two matches on this card where Becky is the champion. You know, and she actually lost one of them. So so the way I think of Becky Lynch, really, when it comes to the big show, the big event, is that she always had to fight her way through victory, you know, and even if she lost, it was a valiant loss.
Yeah, that was one thing I noticed too. And I watch a ton of wrestling, but over there, I'd say the last like 3 years, I haven't really watched much WWE, and not because I don't like it. It's just, you know, I've been on record on Main Event. It's just there's so much other stuff to watch. So for me, it was fun because I've seen most of these matches, but I haven't seen all of them. But my memory, if I think of Becky Lynch, I think of the Sasha Charlotte Becky match, which we'll get to in a little bit, which was kind of the first real big Women's Revolution match on a giant stage.
He literally inaugurated the title with that match.
Yeah, exactly. Like that was mind blowing. I completely forgot. Charlotte still had the Divas title in that match. Yeah. That butterfly belt that I associate with Michelle McCool more than any of the current crop of wrestlers. Right. And then for mostly the three-way with Charlotte and Ronda, where, as you said, she was a total underdog in that match. And really, Charlotte and Ronda got most of the shine in that match. But we can go through that. Why don't we just go match by match? We can go what we talked about, WrestleMania 32, Becky Lynch, Charlotte Flair, Sasha Banks for the brand new Women's Championship. And that was held by Lita, who we'll see a little bit later. Do you have any quick thoughts on the match? I think we just do a little, like, little bullet points from the match, like your quick thoughts.
Very good. A little, it almost felt like, because they had just gotten called up maybe 6 months earlier, so it wasn't like they were brand spanking new out of NXT. They had gotten some opportunities to wrestle on pay-per-views leading up to that. But once they actually wrestled together, it was guaranteed at that point that they were going to have a good match, but it felt rushed. It felt like it was almost like they were given an initiative of, hey, if you ever feel like it's slowing down, do a near fall, which is the Steamboat Savage strategy.
Yeah.
You know, if you notice in the match there, I mean, for those who haven't watched it, me and Steve watched it just for this segment, tons of near falls. If I had to count, probably maybe 20 or 30 of them.
Right off the bat, too. Yeah. I'm not a big fan of triple threat matches in any promotion. They're just kind of a trope where it ends up being someone gets thrown under the ring and lays on the floor for just
and an exorbitant amount of time. And then back and forth. Yeah.
They're like, who actually did it well? Like ECW generally did it well, where they would have a lot of actual three people doing moves on each other at the same time. But I mean, overall, it was a good match. I thought Becky was, you know, she took the fall. She lost by tap out to Charlotte, right? Mm-hmm. And what I found was that Becky was kind of like the third most important person in that match. Sasha had the huge entrance with Snoop. Senior Sal was amazing. And I think that's when we wrap up, one thing I want to look at is like her entrances, which I think is very important in a WrestleMania setting. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Sasha had the huge Eddie tribute going on as well with her outfit. And it's not that I just thought Becky was there, but she was kind of the third most important person in that match. Yeah, she had a sweet steampunk gimmick going, though.
And all three of them are learning.
Yeah.
You still see that they're trying to figure it out. Like, even Charlotte, as she evolves, you know, in later matches, there's one here on this list. But, I mean, we can even go to Charlotte with Rhea Ripley. Totally different from the one that you see here.
Totally. I'm glad you brought that up. I want, like, when we go to 36, I want to bring up something about that match. Meltzer gave this 4 stars. We have the list below of Meltzer, Kenton. And,
that's a bad show. I would probably say that was the best show on the card.
Yeah. Cage match, which I like to look at, especially for older shows, because it's more democratic. 8.49, which is really hard. That's an all-time match right there. When you get above 8, you're like all-time. If you're above 7, that's an excellent match on
Cage highly match. Regarded. Like, people remember it for being really good.
Yeah. Like, I go through like New Japan cards, if it's not above 7, I don't watch it unless it's like something cool that I want to see. Well, WrestleMania 33, we can talk for like 2 minutes and it'll almost be as long as the match itself.
It's like the death slot on this segment.
Yeah.
They got the death slot at WrestleMania 33. It literally goes after the two championship matches. Now, the Orton-Wyatt one is a stinker. Mm-hmm. It's basically like a kaleidoscope match. But then the next one was actually a great sprint between Brock and Goldberg, where they kind of made up for the bad one they had back in the Garden years and years ago. This came right after the Brock Goldberg match and before Roman and Undertaker, which was the main event. So this was like, no one is going to care about this match going into it. And it got 5.5 minutes.
It got 5.5 minutes for six people. Yes. The six-pack challenges, Becky, Naomi, Natalia, Carmella, Alexa Bliss, and Mickie James. And I thought about timing out the entrances to do a compare and contrast. Because yeah. Naomi's entrance alone, and I love Naomi's entrance, always have. That took quite a few minutes just to happen with the...
She's from Orlando, yeah. So you knew that she was going to probably go over. But the other thing was that, and I remember this, and it's a shame for the telecast. I don't remember him bringing this up. Naomi had hurt her knee when she won the belt the month earlier, and she had to surrender it.
Okay.
So Alexa Bliss got it back to get some heel heat. I totally forgot about James Ellsworth being in there. The less I see of him, the better.
Yeah, with Carmella.
Remember, though, James Ellsworth was the first women's Money in the Bank winner. And then, you know, Mickey's there and Becky's there. But in terms of Becky's side, she's okay. Alexa takes the fall here against Naomi, and Naomi wins it back. But in terms of just a match, very, very forgettable.
Very forgettable. Naomi actually going over in her hometown, not something that WWE is known for, but that was good to see. But yeah, no one really had any time to do anything in this match. So it was silent. It did get the death of it. The only pop until the very end was the double sharpshooter attempt by Natalia. So yeah, Becky didn't do that much at all. Meltzer gave it 1.5. Cage match, 3.22, which is abysmal. The only thing worse on this card was the Randy Orton match, which was like a 1 point something, I remember. Yeah. I saw, which... like, that's as bad as you can get.
Because... yeah, and then I remember the month after that, they had that Firefly Funhouse match, which was, like, all-time bad.
Yeah. So WrestleMania 35, a bit different. Charlotte, Flair, and Becky in a three-way again, but this time Ronda Rousey in there. And this is when Ronda was at, you know, this is when she was over. This is when she was big.
Yes.
It's not like, you know, as limited returns after as a couple of years go by where she seemed to be a little more disinterested. But this main evented WrestleMania. So first women's match, so very, very important historically, which gets Becky to move up the list, I'd say. Clearly the crowd favorite here too.
Great. You know, she,
yeah, very much the crowd favorite. Underdog, as you said. Ronda Rousey, I thought this match was really good. It's Meltzer out of 3 stars, but I enjoyed it. Ronda just, you know, she isn't using the fake tan, Ronda, and her body was beat up by the end of this match. But again, like, Ronda and Charlotte got most of the attention in terms of the layout of the match. Becky was the third, and it almost was a fluke win because Becky wrapped her up and Ronda's shoulders were off the mat. That wasn't on purpose, but they pretty much went off the air immediately after. Really, same thing as the Sasha match. A lot of individual single matches going on in this one. Charlotte was really dominant. Ronda was kind of the monster, and Becky was the plucky underdog. What were your thoughts on this?
A very good match. But at the tail end of the last WrestleMania that lasted one entire night, if you actually look at the Peacock timeline on it, it's 5 hours. This is a very long WrestleMania. It is a very good one, WrestleMania 35, the one that was in MetLife. But Ronda goes in as the champion. They kind of turned her heel at the last second because they realized that. And they also turned Charlotte into a total heel. They even got her the SmackDown Women's title off of Asuka, like, right before, so that they could make it like a unification match, which is a Vince-ism, you know, oh, we're going to make it bigger by putting more belts in it. So this was a unification match. And Becky was the one that wasn't a champion, but she was the most overact in WWE at that point after she had gotten her face bloody by Nia Jax. And wrestled Ronda at Survivor Series, but they couldn't because of the broken face. And this was the makeup of like, okay, even though Charlotte versus Ronda was the original idea, let's muscle Becky into there and see what happens. And they had some magic together in that match, all three of them. I thought Charlotte and Ronda had good chemistry. That's why I was really disappointed when 2 years later they wrestled again. I think you hit it on the head where Ronda just didn't seem motivated again. Like when they ran it back, it just, the magic wasn't there anymore. Versus this one where you could definitely see like that they were really collaborating. They were potatoing each other.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of taking some risks, some really nice transitions where it looks like the finishers come in with a submission and then someone comes in with a frog splash or a drop kick or something like that. So there is some good rhythm here. The finish was strange. I don't know if that was on purpose to have it look so like slick, how she rolled her up with the shoulders. In fact, if you watch, once the one count starts, the shoulders are up.
Yeah.
So it was just very sloppy.
I appreciated Corey Graves on there saying that, because I think that's the announcer's responsibility. Because as good as Michael Cole is, it was just like,
they were quick, all ignore it. Their voices were hoarse.
Oh, God. Yeah. He was, his voice was so bad after doing five, probably more once you get pre-show in and that. I can't even imagine having to scream through 5 or 6 hours.
Most WrestleManias at that point between like when the network started and this one were they felt exhausting. This one was actually a really good but exhausting WrestleMania, is what I remembered about it.
Oh, speaking of exhausting, 36. This gets a pass for most matches. This was Becky against Shayna Baszler. Last one, by the way, 6.27 on Cage Match. So a pretty good match.
As a WrestleMania main event, middle of the pack.
Yeah. This one versus Shayna, it's hard to rate. In fact, Meltzer didn't rate it. JT didn't rate it. I would rate it really poorly. And the reason why, and you had mentioned Charlotte and Rhea Ripley. Rhea Ripley, just on the come up, and I really enjoyed that match in that WrestleMania. One of the only regular matches that stood out to me. And that was because they used the environment that was quiet and trash talked each other and made a lot of noise.
That's true.
To make it seem like a fight. And it's something that Roman Reigns picked up during that time too, which I think made him popular, is trash talking when no one could, you know, you had no crowd noise. And this match was like 8 minutes of silence. Becky was silent the whole match. I actually thought that this brought her down in my eyes in terms of being a worker. Shayna, at least, you know, she was selling and trash talking a little bit. I can't tell you how much I hated this match. Even the finish, and it was the way it was booked. It wasn't as much Becky from this aspect. They had done this finish with Shayna Baszler at least twice at this point, where Shayna had the opponent in the Karafuta clutch.
It's the Piper, it's the Bret Hart sleeper finish.
Yeah, and they've done it with Shayna at least three times that I can remember. Twice in NXT, I believe, and then this. I absolutely hated this match.
I liked the match, but there was definitely miscommunications throughout. The fact that it was 8.5 minutes long, I didn't mind, because they were going in with the context that Shayna Baszler had ran like buzzsawed all of her opponents at the Elimination Chamber, which is it's an infamous show because it was the last one before COVID hit and they had to shut things down.
Yeah.
In front of fans. But Shayna had like dominated everybody in that match. And I remember she had this promo where they were trying out things. We're in the third hour Raw because Paul Heyman was booking it. That they were doing something where they would say they were allowed to say the F-bomb or the S-word. And I remember one time she said during one of the little backstage things, "I'm gonna Becky, I'm gonna tear the shit out of you." said it live on USA. And I remember thinking, okay, this one's got some sauce to it, like a feud. I even remember Becky was going to get the big truck, the big semi, they couldn't do it because they were at Orlando behind closed doors. That's all leading up to the match. The match itself, little miscommunication. They all say, like, man, like Charlotte versus Rhea, that show, that could have been really good in front of a crowd. Breaking news, any good match would be better in front of a crowd versus none. All
yes.
If this was in front of a crowd, there was definitely moments that I think could have made it better or been more entertaining. I also thought the announcing, and I like Tom Hannifin, or was known as Tom Phillips at the time. Mm-hmm. I thought they really did this match a disservice. Like I thought they did not pick up the beat of it at all. There's a moment where Becky does her rock bottom finish off. I'm forgetting the name of it off the top of my head that she likes to call it.
Manhandle slam.
And she does it on the apron on her.
Yeah.
And that's supposed to be a big turning point where it's like Shayna is like potatoing the crap out of her and like getting submissions on her. And that's supposed to be a big part where it's like, okay, Shayna's weakened. Becky could get the win here. And then there's another miscommunication in the finish where Becky is about to go out and she rolls backwards and does the Bret Hart finish. And she wakes up immediately after she's let go. That's not the way you go it. The way it was supposed to go is that you are dead. You're done. And you got lucky that you won. And so there's things there that from a beat standpoint that they did not, it did not resonate. Maybe if they had a more experienced WWE women's superstar with her, it could have come off better. But I actually didn't mind the fact that it was less than 10 minutes because I think if it went longer, it would have died an even slower death.
Yeah. And it's hard to
say. Overall, I would say solid, but nothing more than that.
It takes a lot for me to lose interest in a match that's 8 minutes long, but it was one that
she also went out for pregnancy right after that.
Yeah. Well, let's go like the exact opposite because 2 years later, and I got, I'm wearing my Kings of Sports shirt. So I gotta bring up my buddy, Nate Milton, because this match is one that we talked about for a couple of years. WrestleMania 38, Becky Lynch versus Bianca Belair. By far my favorite match out of these. Almost a perfect match, in my opinion. But it came from a bad place. And I'll explain how it's something that still bothers me to this day, but at least I feel they made up for it with this match. But this match came out of the previous WrestleMania, in my opinion, where Sasha and Bianca had one of the most important matches in WrestleMania history. I have the
Black past year's main eventing of WrestleMania.
Absolutely. Yeah. I have my Lester Holt postulate that I've come up with. My Lester Holt postulate is if you do something that in wrestling that gets you on national news, we've seen the extreme with people ahead of WWE, but that was a match that made national news. It was on CNN. It was a very emotional match. I remember it was watching
the best match of the night.
It was best match of the night. I remember getting emotional and getting teary eyed. My wife was in the room and she stopped what she was doing, and she's not a wrestling fan. Came in and sat down. It was a huge match. And then Becky Lynch came back and surprised Bianca Belair. I believe that was at SummerSlam, won in under 30 seconds.
Triggered a heel turn.
But it was just like, Nate always compares it to Kofi Mania, where the exact same thing happened with Brock Lesnar, where you had this huge performance, this huge, Kofi winning at Mania, an incredible moment. And the same exact thing happened, only it was less than 30 seconds.
They take the big name superstar and say, okay, you're going to take it back from this person because we're kind of done with this.
Right. And in just a few months as well. And
the difference is they didn't do this is if Kofi Kingston won it back.
Right.
This is between.
This Bianca is what they didn't do. And that's why, this made up for it quite a bit. It was fantastic. It's her best look at a Mania. It's on the bottom left right now is in our video is the look for this match. Yeah, great intro. And I think her best in-ring performance by far. And maybe just because I like one-on-one matches more.
Overall throughout her career, you mean?
I had to have to go, like I said, I haven't watched much in the last 3 years, but you know, this is about as close to a five-star match as you're getting out of Becky Lynch. Both of them brought out like new wrinkles in their offense, doing moves that they generally don't use. And Bianca is one of my favorite wrestlers too. I was happy to see that she is on the list for that. I think she will be way higher in a couple of years. Yeah, if we go back and do this. I don't want to get too far into talking about Bianca. I put me on her podcast.
They always say Shawn Michaels. I know. I don't know where she is here. She better be high. But if Shawn Michaels is Mr. WrestleMania, Bianca Belair is Miss WrestleMania.
She would be, yeah. And when she gets
to and listen, as we record, she's not booked yet. She will be.
Yeah, she
will. And whatever one she is, it's going to be awesome because she never disappoints.
Yep. Bump around the most athletic wrestler they have.
Challenger. You know, Becky, what Becky showed in this match, and especially versus like 2 years earlier, which with Baszler, which was trying times for everybody, not just like the audiences, as they were always saying, but for the performers themselves, having to rush that match into taping it in a gym.
Yeah.
But for this match, you could tell that Becky was calling it. You could watch it where it's like Becky's telling Bianca, okay, we're going to slow it down here. Mm-hmm. I'm going to get you to rally here, and then I'm going to get the advantage. She does the manhandle slam on the stairs.
Yeah, that was gross.
They even do a nice little tease where the way that she won at SummerSlam with the very quick finish, she tries to do it again but gets the near fall and can't finish her early. So she's got to – so once Bianca starts out-athleticing her, I guess, Becky's got to figure out counters. And she starts countering out of things and starts healing it up some. And it's really, really well done match where there's a clear definition of this is the bad person. This is the good person. This is the strategies going in. And one gets the leg up on the other until Bianca just escapes with a flip and then turns into the KOD. It's a great match. I like Bianca's with Sasha's more because that pure athleticism of that one was better.
Mm-hmm.
But for this one, this is just more of like a WWE style match, but really, really well done. But I would agree that in this list here, that as you look at the bottom, that this was the best one out of the list.
Yeah, cage match had an 8.55, which is a little too close to the 32 for my liking. Meltzer JT gave it 4.5. I 4.5 is good. I mean, even 4.75.
This is also a good show in terms of nights, because now they separate the nights. And this was the one that had Cody show up against Seth Rollins. They had a great one. And I'll say this, Austin Owens, I loved it. It's a nostalgia favorite for me.
Yeah, it was like a fight.
Charlotte Ronda's on this show. I didn't know this until I read it. Charlotte Ronda's on this show.
Yeah.
And this is by far better than that match.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Well, final match, a little bit of a nostalgia tag team match. I didn't see this last year, so this was my first time watching it. So
this is night one.
Yeah, Becky, Lita, Trish Stratus versus Damage Control of Bayley, Dakota Kai, one of my daughter's all-time favorite wrestlers, Dakota Kai, and then Io Sky. It was an average match. Again, Becky, not really the primary story here, in my opinion. It was more kind of the nostalgia factor of Lita and
Trish. Won the tag belts, but the tag belts were not on the line in the match.
Yeah, and then you're also establishing that heel group. Damage Control absolutely dominated the first, like, third to half of the match.
Yeah, that's a surprise, and I think that's a good turn for women's wrestling in general, not just WWE. This was a 15-minute match.
Yeah.
So the idea that even if you're, no matter whether it's male or female, if you have a decent angle, you're going to get time to, especially with two nights of WrestleMania now, you're going to get the time to be able to show your stuff. And Becky did face and peril stuff early.
Yes.
After that, I don't remember too much showcase for her. It was mostly Lita and Trish.
Yeah, because then Lita did face and peril, and then Becky really didn't get involved again until the finish. She helped with some double team moves. It was a little sloppy, but I also get that with Lita and Trish, being
they out of wrestling for so long. Talk about Trish turning heel, but it didn't happen yet. It happens months later. And then they have a rivalry I guess people would call lukewarm.
Yeah. Whereas we ended in that cage match at Trish Stratus made Ronda Rousey's bruises look like scratches. I remember that match being absolutely brutal. But yeah, not much to say about this match. You know, the ratings kind of suggest 2.7, you know, like an average of 3 stars.
What they would say is that it wasn't as bad as the one at 33, where, you know, the booker goes in and they're just like, this is a throwaway. Ah, who cares? Whereas this one, it's like, this is not the most memorable. By the way, this was the same night as Rhea Ripley versus Charlotte. That might be the best women's match ever in WWE. The one in California last year. And so they know their role, no pun intended. Like, they know we're not going to top this. There's other good stuff later. This came after Seth Rollins versus Logan Paul, which the crowd really liked. So they're like, okay,
I got a sponsor. I don't know if you...
That's by Prime.
Yeah, I got sponsored by Prime. I'm going to have it just tattooed across my stomach. I believe that's the new thing to do.
Can you imagine Mick Foley at the top of the cell, and he's just like, I need to hit that Prime right there. If I hit it right there, I'm not going to die. But one way or another, they knew they couldn't do much here. But at least they got 15 minutes. That's all I'm going to say. It wasn't a bad match. It was just
it's perfectly acceptable wrestling. It wasn't terrible. It wasn't fantastic, but it was that nostalgia push.
Crowd liked it. Crowd was hot.
Crowd liked it. I loved Lita. Trish Stratus's, you know, gives me a little smile, but like, Bailey's one of my all-time favorites.
Io Sky is so talented.
Io Sky is just fantastic. I'll go on my Fanatics rant another day. We can do that on the main event. I'll go on my Fanatics rant about damage control. Just kind of in closure, we have her ranked at 23rd overall. Kind of average star rating was like 3.25, 6 total matches, 1 main event. 5 of these matches were for the world title. And based on both our star ratings and what Cage Match says, we have 2 all-time matches, that being 38 and I'm going to forget right away, 32, right? If you're looking at like the strengths of Becky Lynch overall in WrestleMania, what makes her resume stronger?
The fact that if she's given a lot of time with her opponent, the match gets better as it goes along. But it's a matter of how much she showcased. Like, even in the match that we just talked about in 2023, she's not showcased much.
Yeah.
So it's hard to really, and then for a six person match, it's like, come on. Like, you know, anytime I see those at a WrestleMania, it's like, okay, you're just trying to get a check for the boys and the girls. I get it. But there's also this point of like, you're not going to really be able to do much here. And it's also a disservice to what you were building towards with weeks and weeks and weeks. And then you get 5 minutes. So, but when matches would get a little more time, that's when the great stuff happened. I don't think it's a coincidence that like the best one is the one-on-one.
Yeah.
38 with Bianca, because it's 19 minutes and it's just them. It's one-on-one.
It's telling a story.
It's 21 minutes, but it's a triple threat and there's a lot of back and forth there. And it's a main event with these. I will say the entrances for 35 are fantastic for all three women. And then, like I said, 32 felt like a sprint. Like, it felt like they were trying to take all these spots that they learned in NXT that they really liked each other doing, and they just try to smush it. And it's good, but it's not on the level of the one at 38.
Yeah, I'd say like over like Pearl, what makes her stronger is the historic factor of the first women's main event.
Becky Two Belts.
The historical factor of that transition from divas to women's belt being involved in that. Solid in-ring performer, especially when it's in a one-on-one atmosphere or a longer match or with people at her skill level or better. Like, and I can go into cons right away too, but I think might lower her resume. What I hold against her in these bigger matches that are not one-on-one, in these group matches or tag matches, it feels like she's of lesser importance. Now, the crowd in the Charlotte Ronda Rousey match, the crowd wanted her to be of more importance, but the focus was on Charlotte and Ronda until the finish. She was the third most important, in my opinion, in that 33, it really didn't matter.
Yeah.
And in the last match, you're getting damage control over, and you have Lita and Trish Stratus. As
if 36 was there in front of a crowd, she was probably, other than Brock, the hottest act on Raw at the time. So, or Rollins. So, but I think she would have gotten like heavily cheered. That's the other thing too, that you can identify Becky with at WrestleMania, is that crowd participation. The crowd is really invested. For the most part, it's cheers, babyface. So they really like how she has to come up from the bottom. Except for the one against Bianca, where she really identified herself. I'm big time Bex. I took this from you. I'm not letting you take my spot. And they but it really built up, because Bianca is such a great like comeback wrestler. I mean, no one does a comeback like her.
The only other thing, and this is just my own personal taste, and it's not Becky's fault, I don't think, is that I wish that at WrestleMania they would do more with her costuming and entrances. I thought the match with Bianca, again, that was a high point for her. But Bianca also had an entire HBCU band play her out, which was super cool. You know, Bianca makes her own outfits.
She got a superhero montage with Lita and Trish for that one.
Yeah, it was okay.
She was going to get the semi for WrestleMania 36 and didn't get it. Yeah. Her look at 35 was phenomenal. I remember looking at, she looked like the bride in Kill Bill. I remember looking at her like, she's here to kick some ass. Like,
yep, that, I had that one down too.
That was the worst she had. And then for 32, it was weird because, you know, Charlotte had Rick as the accessory, as a manager, and then Sasha came out and had a grand entrance, you know, with the rap song and with and Becky didn't really get one. Becky got just like kind of like,
and she had like a scaled down version of her steampunk look from NXT.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So, the last kicker is what they were calling her at the time.
Yes. Ranked 23 out of 40. Do you think it's just right? Too high, too low?
I think it's just right. And I even think after the match she has with Rhea, it'll be probably the same. Mm-hmm. Because you got to factor in people who might be higher than her that are still participating in WrestleManias. And I think they can have a memorable match. I mean, they're not, it can't be included here because we can't see the future, but I think it's going to be really good.
Yeah. I did a quick, just kind of brainstorm before we went on about the other women. Cause I thought, man, I think Sasha should be higher, and Sasha didn't make the list. But then she was also in a couple of these multi-woman matches over the years. And with being out for 2 years, I feel eventually she'll get another match at Mania. Had the all-timer with Bianca, was also in 32, but just really didn't have as much depth as Becky did. Charlotte, obviously.
She's way up
great. There. Yeah. And I can see Asuka, if she starts getting some singles matches, really up there. Rhea will be up there maybe as soon as this Bianca. Year. Bianca's
got like summer. She's like Sandy Koufax, like the batting average, not the batting, the ERA. It's like super high. Like you put her in there, she's gonna knock it out.
Yeah, she might be passing all of these people in a couple of years.
Correct.
All right, so that was Becky Lynch. Andrew, where else can we find you? We're doing our special here, our countdown. But what are you usually up to?
I don't bring it via satellite much, but I do bring it through the NBA team with Adam Murray. Sometimes I'll appear for the Main Event podcast, like you said, with yourself and Scott and Nate and company. I mean, I have a Twitter handle with the name that you see, at Andrew Reach. And that's really it. You know, just sometimes I dip into the Facebook stuff. But that's it. Just talking basketball, getting ready for March Madness. I'll be doing a show with Mike Rossi for March Madness. This will be the third time.
How many times have you done this now with him?
This will be the third.
Okay. Year.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a great primer. I listen to it every year, right as the tournament starts. it's always a great primer. I haven't missed an episode of NBA Team. I thoroughly enjoy it. I love it. I'll text you pictures of me listening to the car from time to time. But yeah, you can find me, with Andrew and the AEW podcast from time to time. Also on Main Event with Scott. We'll be getting Nate Milton back too. Speaking of Nate, the Kings of Sport podcast, repping right here. You can get this at Chop Tees. And I did a podcast on their Patreon, Kings of Sport, during COVID, and We are bringing it back. It's called DDT Talks. It's the darkest timeline. Be kind of mental health, talking about what's going on in the world, things that are tips and things that are helping us get through just problematic times that it feels like are kind of coming back, but in a different way. So that's on the Patreon feed for Kings of Sport. $5 gets you in the door. But as Nate says, you know, don't worry. If you give more, it's cool. We'll figure out something to do with that.
Right.
So for Andrew Reich, I'm Steve Willey, and this has been the You Know So Connections Greatest WrestleMania Performers of All Time. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you very much for watching. Yeah. And we'll see you soon.
Take care.